So finally, I found some time to produce the sequel to the first video where I showed you guys how you can use pneumatics as a medium through which you can move objects, you know, around your scenes. Now, if you're discovering this video first, then please pause it and watch the first video that I did on it, because there's a lot of things that would make sense or would make more sense if you were to see that one first. I'll drop the link in the banner above as well as in the description below. So in this video, I will be covering more advanced actuators and sort of explaining a bit more about controlling the various rigs and devices. But first guys, if you're new here, then do me a favor and hit that subscribe button real quick. I upload behind the scenes videos, tutorials and reviews based around product commercial production with a focus on motion control and visual engineering. Okay, so you've graduated from the basics and you're confident in using the standard pneumatic cylinder to launch things into the stratosphere. Well, great job and good on you. What else is there though? Well, this, for example, is a gripper actuator. And as you've guessed it, it grips stuff. And it's primarily used as a means of dropping objects by releasing the jaws when you trigger the solenoid. This one in particular has soft jaws and can be used on softer objects like fruits, for example, without, you know, causing too much damage to the skin or to the exterior. And it allows you to drop things of various sizes. So anything that is about that wide to about that wide. Now, this here is also a gripper actuator, and these are a little bit cheaper and a lot more commonly available. They're a lot more readily available. You can find these on eBay and they're not that expensive. But with these ones, you'd have to find a suitable jaw. Now, these are ones I kind of made myself. It's not the best one, and it'd probably be better if you did have a 3D printer. So I'm currently in the market for some new friends. So if you do own a 3D printer, holla at your boy. Okay, up next is the rotary actuator, and this converts pneumatic energy into a rotating motion. Now, these kind of come in various form factors and can vary depending on its intended application as well. Now, this one, for example, was made by Festo, and you can set this up to rotate anywhere between 1 and 270 degrees. And of course, you can adjust the forces which this rotates by adjusting the exhaust ports accordingly. I think this is such a versatile bit of kit, and you can use it in place of an electric motor to an extent. Now, you won't have as much control as you would with a stepper or a servo motor, for example, but you can use it as a dropper or even as a pourer. All you're gonna have to do really is to figure out how you're gonna mount it and what you're gonna attach to the drive in terms of accessories for holding and pouring, setting up your speeds, and yeah, I think that works well as a pourer. You could also use this as a dropper as well. I've used it as a dropper in multiple videos, and I'll just show you a couple examples here. So up next is the dual rod cylinder, and these are primarily used in applications where you want to avoid any twisting motion during the extension and the retraction of the cylinders. So what you can get often in single rod cylinders is twisting motion. So this would either twist on its way up, or it can. There's no way of really stopping that twisting as it comes out. And I've experienced that in the past when I was trying to, you know, push something up and it actually rotated as well. This actually prevents that because you've got two rods here and there is no way that it's going to twist in that plane or in that direction. So it just comes straight up and straight back down. Now, these ones, in my opinion, from what I've found so far, they aren't as powerful or as forceful or as fast as the single rod counterparts, but they could come in very handy if you wanted to just push something, you know, or just slide something up. That'll be pretty handy. I mean, there's cases where you can probably use it as a launcher as well. So whilst we're here, I want to touch a bit on controlling the force or the pressure or the speed, if you'd like, of your setup, and talk about some of the factors that might affect the speed of an actuator. And if we go back and we start with the pressure, let's go back to the source. So at the compressor, this is where you're going to find the highest maximum pressure that that actual compressor could provide for the system. And this pressure is going to kind of decrease the further away you get from the storage tank of the compressor. There's going to be pressure loss in the delivery hoses. Pressure will be lost in the system through leaks. There's going to be pressure loss across your switches, your solenoid valves. through the hoses, all that kind of stuff. So in an ideal world, what we would want to have is we would want to have the pressure that comes out of that compressor to be near at or near where your actuators are going to be operating from, just to help you, you know, deliver maximum force. And whilst we may not want to launch everything into outer space, it's kind of good to have that power and then regulate it down, as opposed to not having it in the first place. Now, a regulator with a pressure gauge is also a good idea because it allows you to have an indication of the pressure near to where your rig is, as opposed to what is back at the compressor. And this one right here has also got a quick release exhaust valve on it, so I can depressurize the rig and vent it to atmosphere before I reset it or I'm working on it or I'm going to disconnect or reconnect it. So that's a good thing to have in the system as well. Now, other things that can affect the speed could be as simple as the quality of the cylinder, you know, the manufacturer. And in this situation, sometimes you do get what you pay for. So maybe it's not always best to like go for the cheapest one, but you'd find out soon enough whether or not that has an effect on your speed as well. Now, I'm going to be honest here, and I'm still learning and finding out more about all this stuff. And if there was a way I could go to a shop and just test all the different types and sizes of these components, I'll probably get to where I need to be a lot quicker. But equally, there's a lot of fun in the learning process and the trials and the testing and, you know, just making it work, getting it to work, and that challenge as well. Okay, so let's take a look at some mounting options. And this is really going to be unique to the actual actuators that you get, to your particular setup, to what you have available, what you're going to mount it to. That's going to be quite unique to you. But we're going to be looking to attach these to light stands, to boom arms, to magic arms and stuff like this. So this one is just a light stand adapter that I've got here. And depending on how you're going to be fitting it, if you're going to be putting it directly onto a light stand, then right, so we can just stick this directly onto a light stand like this. If it's going to go into a socket or it's going to go into a knuckle, then you can just get an adapter like this and feed it in there. This one, for example, it's adjustable. We can adjust the angle on this just to give you a little bit more flexibility. So when you mount it, you can, you know, sort of get it in the right position. And if we look at this one, for example, this is just mounted, you know, pretty much the same way. I had to do a little bit of a jerry rigging on this one to attach another bit of aluminium just so I can screw this in on here. So, you know, there's various ways that you're going to be able to get around this. I'm just going to run you through a couple of demos of how you can actually use this. We've already seen the situation where we can use this as a pourer. What I'm going to do is just switch this up and see how we can actually use it as a dropper as well, for example. So let's say we needed to drop something. This is just a quick example. Let's say we wanted to start from here. What we can do is just make the necessary adjustments for the angle on this. So that's our starting position. And if we wanted it to end up, let's move this around here. If we wanted this to end up a little bit further like this, we can then just move the second stop into position here. So once we reconnect this and reestablish the air, this is where we start in. And if we wanted to use it as a dropper, for example, we can just go ahead and increase the speed. So, you know, there's a few things that you might have to do, tweak it around to get it to work. If we just adjust the ports on here, we can see, we can use it as a dropper. So just by making a quick adjustment, we already have two different uses that we can use a rotary actuator for. And a dropper like this could be handy, for example, if you had something that is a little bit more delicate or fragile, like this biscuit, for example, you might not want to use a gripper, you know, because this might just disintegrate whatever it is that you're trying to drop. You're trying to drop this into a creamy mixture or something like that, then this would probably be the more ideal situation as opposed to crumbling it up. So you just get ready to shoot and there you go. The next one I'm going to show you quickly quickly a demonstration is of this gripper. You've probably seen me use this already before, but we're just gonna set it up real quick. Okay, so for example, we have this gripper here, and you could just release it, position the object that you wanna grip. Now, and because this one has got flexible rubber jaws, it kind of molds around it, so it adds an extra bit of protection to it. But you can also, you know, decrease the working pressure in the system if it's something a little bit more, you know, like delicate, and then all you do, you trigger it, and off you go, it releases it like that. So that is this one. Probably show you the other gripper real quick. It's not as sophisticated as this one. Let's just release the air in this. So that is the operation on this one. For example, if we had, you know, something like this, we just open the jaws and release it. You know, pretty simple things to do. So sometimes that's just an extra hand that you don't need. Obviously you can get somebody to just drop it, but you know, where's the fun in that? Especially if you don't have someone else to drop it for you. So we are talking about visual engineering. We're talking about repeatability. So things like this in the system just gives you a lot more control over your shooting. So just to give you a closer look at this rotary actuator we have here, we can see we have the stops here. So these are your bump stops, and this is the total degree. So that's 270 degrees of rotation, and you can adjust these bump stops anywhere that you like, and that would, you know, restrict the motion or confine the motion of this drive in between those points. So all you have to do is just tighten these down, you know, to give you that degree of movement, and then yeah, off you go. So it's as simple as that. Now, as a bonus, I'm going to show you a use case scenario where we're going to use two actuators in a motion control high-speed sequence. Now, I'm going to use the rotary actuator to pour a liquid into a glass, just like we've demonstrated earlier, and then I'm going to have the gripper drop a block of ice into the glass after the fact. Now, these actuators will be triggered via software as part of the move, so everything will be perfectly timed. And that was pretty dope, right? So if we think about all of these little devices, all of these different components as, you know, parts of or instruments, for example, within a band or within an orchestra, and you combine them and you put them all together, and they just work to create a really amazing, you know, sort of end results. Anyways, guys, that was a lot of info, and I feel like this topic is so extensive, you know, it might need more than two episodes. So let me know if you would want to see a part three, and I'll try to put together something at some point in the future. Now, if you found this useful, let me know in the comments below. And even more importantly, if you have any pneumatic tips and tricks, please let us know in the comments below. And make sure to follow me over on Instagram, and I'll see you guys on the next one. Peace.